Our next speaker is Dr. Mark Ranjan Jesudason. He's Professor of General Surgery here in CMC Vellore. He's the SHOQCON faculty for basic surgical skills, basic laparoscopic surgery, advanced laparoscopic surgery, particularly in colorectal surgery. He heads our colorectal unit and also heads our theater steering committee. Over to you, Dr. Ranjan.
Thank you, Dr. Priya, for those words of introduction. So over the next 10 minutes, what I hope to do is to be able to give you an overview as to how we use what we call surgical indicators as a tool to improve quality of surgical service delivery. There are a whole lot of tools that are used to improve surgical care, and these are the audits that we do, morbidity and mortality meetings, incident reports, and each one of these are very important tools from which there are valuable lessons learned. I'm going to stick to the use of surgical indicators for the next 10 minutes. So now, what does an indicator do? Most of us are used to this term indicator when we look at lab tests and sterilization and things like that. So an indicator basically is a tool that you use to assess quality. So the indicator will reflect quality, and then you have indicators that reflect adherence to certain basic established procedures and protocols. Now, while choosing an indicator, you need to have an indicator that's accurate. You need to have an indicator that's relevant to the problem that you're thinking of assessing. You need to have an indicator that you can continue to measure. It has to be reproducible. You should measure it today. You should be able to measure it tomorrow, 1 week from now, 1 month from now, a year from now. And it should be the same yardstick that is used, which will enable you to compare the actual quality and therefore see whether the quality is actually improving or not. And it should be something that's easy to track and analyze. And I would like to stress on this ease of tracking and analyzing, because all of us, most of us sitting in this audience are clinicians. Most people working in a hospital are clinicians. And we are busy with clinical work. And the most and the surest way to make sure that something is not done is to make something complex. So if you want something done, you've got to choose something that's easy. And that is something which over the years we have developed in our institution as far as developing quality indicators for assessing surgical safety and surgical quality. So if you look at indicators, there are indicators that are global, which kind of assess the surgical service in a region or in a state or in a district. And then you have indicators that assess the problem very locally. You have indicators that are generic, and then you have indicators that are specific to certain diseases or certain operations even, or certain units. So I will spend the few, we will go through these one by one. So we'll go through, look at global indicators first. And this list of five indicators came up as a result of a lot of deliberation by this commission that was set up in 2015. It's called the Lancet Commission on Global Surgery. And basically what they were trying to do is look at surgical care delivery. And they looked at these five, they raised these five questions. So they wanted to know whether a patient could access surgery which was life-saving at the right time. Was he able to access the right specialist? Did the specialist have adequate experience by surgical volume? What was the chance of dying from that particular operation? And what was the affordability? Now, these are very administrative areas and are probably under the purview of administrators and healthcare planners. And I'm sure there are some of you sitting in the audience who will be taking on such a role. Now we come on to local problems that are common to surgical departments or units of the hospital. But these are things which have to be indicators that have to be measurable across the board in all surgical specialties. And this is what we use in our institution, and this is common for all surgical specialties. And if you look at it, all these indicators are very generic. You look at the total number of operations, which looks at your workload and therefore experience, because we know that With increased volume, you have increased quality. And there are a list of events which we look at, surgical re-exploration rate, number of times intraoperatively we've changed plans, surgical site infections, unplanned ventilation, wrong side operations, wrong operation, readmission rate, and also the number of, and also sentinel events that are recorded. Now, these are recorded on a weekly basis in our department and in all the other surgical departments in the institution, and are sent to the office of the medical superintendent and the quality management cell, and they collate this, analyze it, and give us their findings at the end of at periodic intervals. Now, you have to remember that these have to be tracked very accurately and recorded individually. And, you know, I work in a surgical unit which is not very large, and we do not have many patients compared to the numbers which Dr. Anita was talking about in the Department of Anesthesia. So it's much easier for us to keep track of this. You need to be able to analyze it. So once we send it to the quality management cell, they analyze it. And it's important that we know where we stand, both at an individual level, as an institution, and how we compare with each other. Now, how does my unit compare with the other surgical unit with respect to surgical site infections? And if I find that somebody else has got less surgical infections than me, then maybe I should go and learn something from them. And remember, this is a situation where we cannot really put the onus on the management for collecting and tracking these indicators. And it's important that we as clinicians take primary responsibility for the tracking and recording of these indicators, whereas the management can help in analyzing it and giving us their feedback periodically. And this is the last bit, which is specific indicators. These are specific to diseases. It may be specific to an operation. They are tracked and recorded individually, and we compare it. And here, what we do is, in our unit, we compare it with, you know, I'm a colorectal surgeon, and we deal with a lot of colorectal malignancies. We track our quality indicators and compare them with universally accepted international benchmarks and with centers which are doing high volume colorectal work. And this is an area where the clinicians are primarily responsible. You cannot put this the onus of this on the management. I'm going to spend a couple of minutes on this. There's this group called Cancer Care Ontario which came up with a list of quality care indicators to be able to achieve these objectives which I have put up on my slide. And these are the indicators that we use for patients with colon and rectal cancer. And you will see it's just 9 guidelines. And you'll see a lot of it is the process which is followed, more than 50%. And it's only these 4 which are actually looking at the quality of the operation done. So just to remind ourselves, we need to, an indicator is something that reflects quality, and it also reflects adherence to procedure. And this is often sometimes where, you know, where many clinicians have a problem. Now, we keep asking ourselves, why should I adhere to this procedure? Why do I have to do this? As long as my outcome is good, I'm not bothered what procedures followed. I'm not bothered about all these protocol details. We need to remember that quality indicators are of 3 broad categories. There are indicators that reflect resources, resource availability. There are indicators that reflect adherence to certain processes. And there are indicators that reflect outcome. And the experience of the Cancer Care Ontario group is this, that as long as you have the appropriate resources and follow the correct process, the chances are that you will have a good outcome. And it is this repetitive, mundane, boring process of sticking to protocol that eventually gives good outcome. And you don't need to be a brilliant surgeon to be able to deliver good outcomes. You need to keep doing the same thing again and again and again in the right way. Now, this is a bit which I've added on. So once you track a quality indicator and you analyze it, you need to do post-analysis intervention. And unfortunately, this is the single impediment to quality improvement. Lalu will tell you our quality management cell does loads and loads and loads of audits. And she will also tell you that these audits will be of no use if there's no action taken on the findings of the audit. And so you have to track your indicator and keep seeing where you can improve and keep tracking the indicator again and again. So it is, in a sense, closing the loop, which all of you are familiar with. It's a phrase that you're all familiar with in conducting audits. But here, this is an ongoing loop which keeps looping again and again and again, and you've got to keep doing it year after year after year. So to conclude, use of surgical quality indicators is a fantastic tool in improving quality. But you need to select a good indicator that's relevant and universally accepted and useful. You need to track it very diligently and honestly. You've got to analyze it without bias, and it's good that we have an external group that does the analysis for us. You need to intervene, and you need to continue to track. And that completes the cycle. And if we continue to do this seemingly boring process, many of us who've done large volumes of surgical work will be able to vouch that this certainly improves the outcome of surgical care much more than a brilliantly performed operation will. So with that, I'd like to wind up and thank you all for your patient listening.